My name is Guillermo Lozetti, and today I'm going to be reading with you A Sound of Thunder by Ray Bradbury. Let's begin. The sign on the wall seemed to quaver under a film of sliding warm water. Echoes fell his eyelids, blink over his stare, and the sign burned into momentary darkness. Time Safari Incorporated. Safaris any year in the past. You name the animal. We'll take you there. You shoot it. Warm fen gathered in Echo's throat. He swallowed and pushed it down. The muscles around his mouth formed a smile as he put his hand slowly out upon the air, and in that hand waved a check for $10,000 to the man behind the desk. Does this safari guarantee you'll come back alive? We guarantee nothing, said the official. Except the dinosaurs, he turned. This is Mr. Travis, your safari guide in the past. He'll tell you what and where to shoot. If he says no shooting, no shooting. If you disobey instructions, there's a stiff penalty of another $10,000, plus possible government actions on your return. Echoes glanced across the vast office at a mass entangle, a snaking of humming of wires at steel boxes. An aura flickered, now orange, now silver, now blue. There was a sound like a gigantic bonfire burning all of the time, all of the years, and all of the parchment calendars, all of the hours, piled high, and set aflame. A touch of the hand and this burning world, on the instant, beautifully reverse itself. Echoes remembered the wording in the advertisements to the letter. Out of chars and ashes, out of dust and coals, like golden salamanders, the old years, the green years, might leap, rose and sweeten the air. White hair turn Irish black, wrinkles vanish. All everything fly back to seed. Flee death rush down to their beginnings. Suns rise in the western skies and set in glorious east. Moons eat themselves in opposite to the custom. All and everything cupping in one another like the Chinese boxes. Rabbits into hats. All and everything returning to the fresh death. The seed death. The green death. To the time before the beginning. A touch of a hand might do it. The merest touch of a hand. Unbelievable, Echoes breathed. The light of the machine on his thin face. A real time machine. He shook his head. Makes you think. If the election had gone badly yesterday, I might be there now running away from the results. Thank God Keith won. He'll make a fine president of the United States. Yes, said the man behind the desk. We're lucky. If Dushner have got it, we would have the worst kind of dictatorship. There's an anti-everything man for you. A militarist, an anti-Christian, an anti-human, an anti-intellectual. People called us up, you know, joking, but not joking. Said if Dushner became president, they wanted to go live in 1492. Of course, it's not our business to conduct escapees, but to form safaris. Anyway, Keith's president now. All you gotta worry about is shooting my dinosaur, Echoes finished for him. A Tyrannosaurus Rex, the tyrant lizard, the most incredible monster in history. Sign this release. Anything happened to you, we're not responsible. Those dinosaurs are hungry. Echoes flushed angrily. Trying to scare me? Frankly, yes. We don't want anyone who will panic at the first shot. 6 safari leaders were killed last year, and a dozen hunters. We're going to give you the severest thrill of a real hunter ever asked for. Traveling you back 60 million years to bag the biggest game in all of time. Your personal check's still there. Tear it up. Mr. Echoes looked at the check. His fingers twitched. Good luck, said the man behind the desk. Mr. Travis, he's all yours. They moved silently across the room, taking their guns with them, towards the machine, towards the silver metal and roaring light. First a day, and then a night, and then a day, and then a night. It was day, night, day, night. A week, a month, a year, a decade. AD 2055. AD 2019. 1999. 1957. A machine roared. They put their oxygen helmets and tested the intercoms. Eccles swayed on the paddled seat, his face pale, his jaw stiff. He felt the trembling in his arms and looked down and found the hands tight on the new rifle. There were four other men in the machine. Travis, the safari leader, his assistant, Leperance, and two other hunters, Billings and Kramer. They sat looking at each other, and the years blazed around him. "Can these guns get a dinosaur colt?" Eccles found his mouth saying. "If you hit him right," said Travis on the helmet radio, "some dinosaurs have two brains, one in the head, another far down in the spinal column. We stay away from those. That's stretching luck." "If you hit them right," said Travis on the helmet radio, "put your first shots into the eyes. If you can, blind them, and then go back into the brain." The machine howled. Time was film run backward. Suns fled, and 10 million's mood fled after them. "Think," said Eccles, "every hunter that ever lived would envy us today. This makes Africa seem like Illinois." The machine slowed. Its scream fell to a murmur. The machine stopped. The sun stopped cold in the sky. The fog that had enveloped the machine blew away, and they were in an old time, a very old time indeed. Three hunters and two safari heads, the metal guns across their knees. "Christ isn't born yet," said Travis. "Moses has not gone to the mountains to talk with God. The pyramids are still in the earth, waiting to be cut out and put up. Remember that, Alexander, Caesar, Napoleon, Hitler, none of them exists. That, Mr. Travis, is the jungle of 60,002,055 years before President Keith." He indicated a metal path that struck into the green wilderness, over streaming swamp, among the giant ferns and palms. "And that," he said, "is the path laid by Time Safari for your use. And it floats 6 inches above the earth, doesn't touch so much as one glass blade, flower, or tree. It's anti-gravity metal. Its purpose is to keep you from touching the world and the past in any way. Stay on the path. Don't go off of it. I repeat, don't go off. For any reason, if you fall off, there's a penalty. And we do not shoot the animal. Okay?" "Why?" asked Eccles. They sat in the green wilderness. Far birds' cries flew on a wind, and the smell of tar, and an old sea salt, moist grasses, the flowers of the colored blood. "We don't want to change the future. We don't belong here in the past. The government doesn't like us here, but we have to pay a big graft to keep our franchise. A time machine is a finicky business, not knowing it. We might kill an important animal, a small bird, a roach, a flower even, thus destroying an important link in a growing species." "That's not clear," said Eccles. "All right," Travis continued. "Say we accidentally kill one mouse right here. That means all the future families of this one particular mouse are destroyed, right?" "Right. And all the families of the families of that one mouse. With the stamp of your foot, you annihilate the first one. Then a dozen, then a thousand, then a million, then a billion possible mice. So they're dead," said Eccles. "So what?" "So what?" Travis snorted quietly. "Well, what about the foxes that need those mice to survive? For want of 10 mice, a fox dies. For want of 10 foxes, a lion starves. For want of a lion, all manner of insects, vultures, infinite billions of life forms are thrown into chaos and destruction. Eventually, it all boils down to this. 59 million years later, a caveman, one of a dozen on the entire world, goes hunting. Wild boar, saber-toothed tiger for food. But you, friend, have stepped on all the tigers in that region. By stepping on one single mouth, Mouse. So the caveman starves. And the caveman, please note, is not just any expendable man. No, he's an entire future nation. From his loins would have sprung 10 sons, from their loins 100 sons, thus onward to a civilization. Destroy one man, you destroy a race, a people, an entire history of life. It is incomparable to slaying some Adam's grandchildren. The stomp of your foot on one mouse could start an entire earthquake. The effects could shatter our earth and destinies down through time to their very foundations. With the death of one caveman, 1 billion others yet unborn and are throttled in the womb. Perhaps Rome never rises on its 7 hills. Perhaps Europe is forever a dark forest, and Asia waxes healthy and teeming. Step on a mouse and you crush the pyramids. Step on a mouse and you leave your print, like a grand canyon across eternity. Queen Elizabeth might never be born. Washington might never cross the Delaware. There might never be a United States at all. So be careful. Stay on the path. Never step off. I see, said Eccles. Wouldn't pay for us to even touch the grass? Correct. Crushing certain plants can add up infinitesimally. And a little error would multiply in 60 million years, all out of proportion. Of course, maybe our theory is wrong. Maybe time can't be changed by us. Maybe it can only be changed in little subtle ways. A dead mouse here makes an insect imbalance. And a popular disproportion later. A bad harvest further. On a depression, a mass starvation, and finally, change on social temperament in flung countries. Something much more subtle like that. Perhaps only a soft breath, a whisper, a hair, pollen onto the air. Such a slight change that unless you look close enough, you wouldn't see it. Who knows? Who really can't say he knows? We don't know. We're guessing, but do we know for certain we're being careful? This machine, this path, your clothing and bodies were sterilized, as you know, before the journey. We wear these oxygen helmets so we can't introduce our bacteria into an ancient atmosphere. How do we know which animals to shoot? They're marked with red paint, said Travis. Today, before our journey, we sent Les Perez here back with the machine. He came to this particular era and followed around certain animals. Studying them. Right, said Lesperance. I track them through our entire existence. Nothing from which those lives longest. Very few. How many times they mate? Not often. Life short. When I find one that's going to die when a tree falls on them, or one that drowns in a tar pit, I note the exact hour, minute, and second. I try and shoot a paint bomb. It leaves a red match on its side. We can't miss it. Then I correlate our arrival in the pass so that we meet the monster no more than 2 minutes before he would have died anyways. This way, we kill animals with no future that are never going to mate again. Do you see how careful we are? But if you come back this morning in time, said Eccles eagerly, you must have bumped into us, our safari. How did it turn out? Was it successful? Did all of us go through alive? Travis and Lesperance gave each other a look. That'd be a paradox, said the letter. It doesn't permit the sort of mess a man meeting himself. When such occasions threaten, time steps aside, like an airplane hitting an air pocket. You felt the machine jump before we stopped. That's the passing of ourselves in a way back into the future. We saw nothing. There's no way of telling if the expedition was a success. If we got our monster, or whether all of us meeting you, Mr. Eccles got alive. Eccles smiled patiently. Cut that out, said Travis shortly. Everyone on his feet. They were ready to leave the machine. The jungle was high, and the jungle was broad, and the jungle was the entire world forever and forever. Sounds like the music. Sounds like the flying tents filled the sky. Those were pterodactyls soaring with the cavernous gray wings. Gigantic bats of delirium and night fever. Eccles, balanced on the narrow path, aimed his rifle playfully. "Stop that," said Travis. "Don't even aim for fun. Blast you, if your guns go off." Echoes flushed. "Where's our Tyrannosaurus?" Lesperus checked his wristwatch. "Up ahead. We'll bisect his trail in 60 seconds. Look for the red paint. Don't shoot till we give the word. Stay on the path. Stay on the path." They moved forward in the wind of the morning. "Strange," murmured Eccles. "Up ahead, 16 million years ago, election day over. Keith made the president. Everyone's celebrating, and here we are, a million years lost, and they don't exist. The things we're worried about for months, a lifetime, not even born of thought yet." "Safety catches off, everyone," ordered Travis. "Your first shot, Eccles. Second, Billings. Third, Kramer. I've hunted tiger, wild boar, buffalo, elephant, but now this is it," says Eccles. "I'm shaking like a kid." "Ah," said Travis. Everyone stopped. Travis raised his hand. "Ahead," he whispered, "in the mist. There he is. There's his royal majesty now." The jungle was wide and full of twitterings, rustlings, murmurs, and sighs. Suddenly it all ceased, as if someone shut the door. Silence. A sound of thunder. Out of the mist, 100 yards away, came Tyrannosaurus Rex. "It," whispered Eccles. "It." It came on gray, oiled, resolute, striding legs. It towered 30 feet above half the trees, a great, evil god, folding its delicate watchmaker's claws, closed its openly rashrin chest. Each lower leg was a piston, thousands of pounds of white bone, suck in thick ropes of muscle, seethe over in gleam of pebbled skin like the mail of a terrible warrior. Each thigh was a ton of meat, ivory, string, and steel mesh, and from the great breathing cage of the upper body, those two declined arms dangle in front, arms with the hand of it might pick up and examine men like toys, while the snake coiled, and the head itself, a ton of sculptured stone, lifted easily upon the sky, its mouth gap, exposing a fence of teeth like daggers, its eyes rolled, ostrich eggs, empty of all expression to save hunger. It ran with gilding ballot step, far too poisoned and balanced for its 10 tons. It moved into a sunlit area warily, its beautiful reptilian hands feeling the air. Why? Eccles twitched his mouth. "It could reach up and grab the moon." "Shh," Travis jerked angrily. "He hasn't seen us yet." "It can't be killed," Eccles pronounced the verdict quietly, as if there could be no argument. He had weighed the evidence, and this was his considered option. His rifle in his hand seemed a cap gun. "We're no fools to come. This is impossible." "Shut up," hissed Travis. "Nightmare." "Turn around," commanded Travis. "Walk quietly to the machine. We will remit half your fee." "I didn't realize it would be this big," said Eccles. "I miscalculated. That's all. Now I want out." "It sees us. There is red paint on its chest." The tyrant lizard raised itself. Its armored flesh glittered like 1,000 green coins. The coins, crusted with slime, steamed. In the slime, tiny insects wriggled so that the entire body seemed to twitch and undulate. Even while the monster itself didn't move, it exhaled. The stink of raw flesh blew down the wilderness. "Get me out of here," said Eccles. "It never was like this before. I was always sure I'd come through alive. I had good guides, good safaris, and safety. This time, I figured wrong. I bent my match, and I admit it. It's too much for me to get a hold of." "Don't run," said Lesperance. "Turn around. Hide in the machine." "Yes," Eccles seemed to be numb. He looked as at his feet, trying to make them move. He gave a grump of helplessness. Eccles. He took a few steps, blinking, shuffling. Not that way. The monster, at first motion, lunged forward with a terrible scream. It covered 100 yards in 6 seconds. The rifles jerked up and blazed fire. A windstorm from the beast's mouth engulfed them into the stench of slime and old blood. The monster roared, teeth glittering with the sun. The rifles cracked again. Their sound was lost in shriek and lizard thunder. The great level of reptile's tail swung up, lashed sideways. Trees exploded in clouds of leaf and branch. The monster twitched its jeweler's hands down to the fondle at the men. To twist them in half, to crush them like berries, to cram them into its teeth and in its screaming throat, its boulder stone eyes leveled with the men. They saw themselves mirrored. They fired at the metallic eyes and the blazing black iris. Like stone idol, like a mountain's avalanche, the Tyrannosaurus fell. Thundering, it clutched trees, pulled them with it. It wrenched and tore the metal path. The men flung themselves back and away. The body hit. Tens of tons of cold flesh and stone. The guns fired. The monster lashed its armored tail, twitched its snake jaws, and lay still. A font of blood spurted from its throat. Somewhere inside, a sack of fluids burst. Sickening gushes drenched the hunters. They stood, red and glistening. The thunder faded. The jungle was silence. After the avalanche, a green peace. After the nightmare morning, Billings and Kramer sat on the pathway and threw up. Travis and Lasperin stood with smoking rifles, cursing steadily. In the time machine on his face, Eccles lay shivering. He had found his way back to the path, climbed onto the machine. Travis came walking, glanced at Eccles, took a cotton gauze from the metal box, returned to the others who were sitting on the path. Clean up. They wiped the blood from their helmets. They began to curse too. The monster lay, a hill of solid flesh. Within, you could hear the sighs and murmurs as the furthest chambers of it died, the organs malfunctioning, liquids running a final instant from pocket to sac to spleen. Everything shutting off, closing up forever. It was like standing by a wrecked locomotive or a steam shovel at quitting time. All valves were being released or levered tight. Bones cracked. The tonnage of its own flesh, off balance, dead weight, snapped the delicate forearms caught underneath. The meat settled, quivering. Another cracking sound. Overhead, a gigantic tree branch broke from its heavy mooring. Fell, it crashed upon the dead beast with finality. There, Lasperin checked his watch. Right on time. That's the giant tree that was scheduled to fall and kill this animal originally. He glanced at two hunters. You want the trophy picture?
What?
You can't take that trophy back to the future. The body has to stay right where it would have died originally, so the insects, the birds, and the bacteria can get at it, as they were intended to. Everything unbalanced. The body stays up. But we can take a picture of you standing near it. The two men tried to think, but gave up, shaking their heads. They let themselves be led along the metal path. They sank warily into the machine cushions. They gazed back at the ruined monster, the staggering mound, where already strange reptilian birds and golden insects were busy at the steaming armor. A sound on the floor of the time machine stiffened them. Eccles sat there, shivering. I'm sorry, he said at last. Get up, cried Travis. Eccles got up. Go out on the path alone, said Travis. He had his rifle pointed. You're not coming back in the machine. We're leaving you here. Lasperin seized Travis' arm. Wait. Stay out of this. Travis shook his hand away. This fool nearly killed us. But it isn't that so much. No, it's his shoes. Look at them. He ran off the path. That ruins us. We'll forfeit thousands of dollars of insurance. We'll guarantee that no one leaves the path. He left it. Oh, the fool. I'll have to report this to the government. They might revoke our license to travel. Who knows what he's done to time? To history. Take it easy. All he did was kick up some dirt. How do we know, tried Travis. We didn't know anything of all its mystery. Get out of here. Echoes fumbled his shirt. I'll pay anything. Hundreds of thousands of dollars. Travis glared at Echoes' cheekbook and spat. Go out there. The monster's next to the path. Stick your arms up and elbows into his mouth. Then you can come back with us. That's unreasonable. The monster's dead, you idiot. The bullets can't be left behind. They don't belong in the pass. They might change anything. Here's my knife. Dig them out. That's unreasonable. The jungle was alive again, full of old tremblings and bird cries. Echoes turned slowly to regard the primeval garbage dump. But the hill of nightmares and terror, after a long time, like a sleepwalker, he shuffled out along the path. He returned, shuddering. 5 minutes later, his arms soaked and red to the elbows, he held out his hands. Each held a number of steel bullets. Then he fell. He lay where he fell, not moving. You did not have to make him do that, said L'Esperance. Oh, didn't I? It's too early to tell. Travis nudged the body still. He'll live. Next time he won't go hunting game like this. Okay? He jerked his thumb wearily at L'Esperance. Switch on. Let's go home. 1492, 1796, 1812. They cleaned their hands and faces. They changed their caking shirts and pants. Echo was up and around again, not speaking. Travis glared at him for a full 10 minutes.
Don't look at me, cried Echoes.
I haven't done anything. Who can tell? Just ran off the path, that's all. A little mud on my shoes. What do you want me to dodge it down and pray? We might need it. I'm warning you, Echoes. I might kill you yet. I've got my gum ready. I'm innocent. I've done nothing. 1999, 2000, 2055. The machine stopped. Get out, said Travis. The room was there they had left it, but not quite the same as they had left it. The man sat behind the desk, but the same man did not quite sit behind the desk. Travis looked around swiftly. Everything okay here? He snapped. Fine. Welcome home. Travis did not relax. He seemed to be looking through one high window. Okay, Echoes, get out. Don't ever come back. Echoes could not move. You heard me, said Travis. What are you staring at? Echoes stood smellingly of the air. There was one thing to the air. A chemical taint. So subtle, so slight, that only a faint cry of the subliminal senses warned him that it was there. The colors. White, gray, blue, orange. In the wall. In the future, in the furniture, the sky beyond the windows were, and there was a feel. His flesh twitched, his hands twitched. He stood drinking the oddness with the pores of his body. Somewhere, someone must have been screaming on those whistles, though only a dog can hear. His body screamed silence in return. Beyond this room, beyond this wall, beyond this man that was not quite the same man seated at the desk was not quite the same desk, lay an entire world of streets and people. What sort of world it was now? There was no telling. He could feel them moving there, beyond the walls, almost like so many chess pieces blown in a dry wind. But the immediate thing was the sign painted on the office wall, same sign he had read earlier today on the first entry. Somehow, the sign had changed. Time Safari Incorporated. Safaris to any year and past to name the animal. We took yar there. You shoot it. Echoes felt himself fall into a chair. He fumbled crazily at the thick slime on his boots. He held up a clod of dirt, trembling. No, it can't be. A little thing like that. No. Embedded in the mud, glistening green and gold back, was a butterfly. Very beautiful. Very dead. Not a little thing like that. Not a butterfly, cried Echoes. It fell onto the floor, an exquisite thing. A small thing that could upset the balances, knock down a small line of dominoes, and then a big dominoes, and then gigantic dominoes, and then all the years across time. Echo's mind whirled. It couldn't change things. Killing one butterfly couldn't be that important. Could it? His face was cold. His mouth trembled, asking, "Who won the presidential election yesterday?" The man behind the desk laughed. "You're joking. You knew very well. Jutcher, of course. Who else? Not that fool weakling Keith. We got an Iron Man now. A man with guts." The official stopped. "What's wrong?" Eccles moaned. He dropped to his knees. He scrubbed the golden butterfly with shaking fingers. "Can't we?" he pleaded to the world, to himself, to the officials, the machine. "Can't we take it back? Can't we make it alive again? Can't we start over? Can't we?" He did not move. Eyes shut. He waited, shivering. He heard Travis breathe loud in the room. He heard Travis shift his rifle, click the safety catch, and raise the weapon. There was a sound of thunder. I hope you guys enjoyed watching me read this. Bye!